Hi everyone. My name is Pooja and I have almost more than 10 years of work experience in IP field. So whenever we interact with inventors, specifically I'm talking about inventors who are associated with small or medium firms or maybe individual inventors, they disclose their inventions and the first reaction as an IP attorney or an IP professional that I have and I have seen people around me, they have is we tell them, see boss, if you are talking to anybody in the, if you're talking to any of your customers or potential licensors regarding this product, I would suggest you first you quickly file a patent application and protect your IP. And this goes on for like almost everybody, irrespective of what that inventor is dealing with, what is the kind of product he is dealing with, what is his business strategy. We are not even sure whether the idea that he has in his mind right now, or maybe the product that is in the prototype stage, whether tomorrow he'll be able to really commercialize it. And the first reaction is you go and file the patent, you protect your IP. So I was thinking if our advice is based simply on one fact that they think it is something new they are doing, is it really an IP strategy? Because strategy would involve a lot of different circumstances, maybe some data churning, and then arrive at a conclusion. So this takes us to a question where this IP management, is it a strategic decision or just an intuitive voice? This was about a smaller medium firm or maybe single inventor. Now, since we are talking about IP management and innovation, we can't complete our talk without talking about Amazon. So, of course, we know Amazon is amazing as far as their product, services, and innovation is concerned. So I'm going to talk about the expedited delivery. So Amazon, of course, we know their business model, the core business model. They are coming up with a lot of different things right now. Their core business model is of course, they deliver products, whatever you order. I don't need to tell that. They came up with a problem that people wanted faster deliveries. Earlier it was maybe in the range of some 5 to 7 days. Now they have kind of reduced it to 1 to 2 days, and they are trying to reduce it even more. So they are trying to address a problem, address a situation which even Spider-Man could not do. They have come up with a solution called Amazon Prime Air, and they are really working on it, and they claim that they'll be able to deliver products within 30 minutes of ordering. When you click a button which says buy, within 30 minutes you will have it. So this is one of the solutions they are kind of working on it, and last month they have made their first delivery already. So again, I'm coming back to the same question. When Amazon would have thought about this problem, the kind of solution, like using drones, it came to their mind. Was it a strategic decision, or was it just an intuitive decision? The CEO would have thought, this is the best we can do it in quick delivery. He would have thought about the challenges, because even till date, though they have made the first delivery and they are working a lot on this idea, there are a lot of challenges which are there. So this is one of the patents which they have filed. Again, this patent is solving the problem of expedited delivery. So they want to make expedited delivery by the solution. You are using the solution which is provided there. So the patent, it talks about anticipatory package shipping. Now, what is anticipatory package shipping? I'm not getting into details of the patent, but what they are doing is, they are, even before you click a buy button, they are anticipating that you will be going to buy this product. They will ship the product to a place which is called fulfillment center. It's an infrastructure which Amazon is going to maintain. And so as soon as you order, maybe if not within 30 minutes, maybe in 1 day or half a day, it will reach you. Now this is, whatever I've spoken till now is not really amazing about Amazon. The amazing part is, it got filed in 2012, got granted in 2014. However, the idea was conceived in 2004. This is amazing part. Now, why it is amazing? In 2004, probably Amazon was still getting into this business, understanding the business market and everything. 12 years before, they could see what would be the challenge they would be facing. 10 years down the line, they worked on the challenge and they filed a patent and they got a grant. So by the way, this has a priority date. This is a divisional application of the original application. So I'm again coming back to the same question. Was that just a gut feeling that this will happen? Or was that really some strategy going on in the company where they envisioned the problem? So for the last 2 days, I've been listening a lot of things, and people are telling your IPC strategy has to be in alignment with business strategy. What Amazon follows is IP strategy is aligned with future business strategy. So they think ahead at least 10 years and they align their IP strategy with their future business strategy. So this is about IP strategy. Now, when we talk about IP strategy, it's not something that comes out of the blue. There's a lot of data that you have to churn, and for deriving IP strategy, we have a structured data and an unstructured data. The structured data is definitely that comes from bibliographic data present in the patents, patent documents granted and applications as well. The unstructured data, which has now become an important part of our strategy studies, includes a lot of things like you determine the claim scope, you determine the claim coverage, you look at the prosecution histories, you see where the technology is going, and these are few of the patent related unstructured data I'm talking about. There's a lot of non-patent structured unstructured data which is available, and people definitely use that data. So using this data, you come up with certain indicators which represent the portfolio strength of your existing product, technology that you're working on. It could be your portfolio strength, it could be your competitor's portfolio strength, it could be anything. So when we are looking at the portfolio strength, there are around 150 indicators that can really define the portfolio strength. However, right now I'm considering just 7 of them, because these are the ones which are used most commonly. And again, these can be clubbed into four specific categories. First is the kind of portfolio you have. So it will see your portfolio size, and it will see how the portfolio impetus, which means how quickly it is your portfolio is increasing and shrinking. Then second is your citation. The citation can give a lot of important information. If you look at self citations, a company has filed in a core technology, and then it has built citations around the technology. Those are called self citations. Now, self citations can also be single generation and multi generation self citations. For example, you are in a technology where you filed a core patent, you built around it by a single layer of citations, and then technology has moved on to another phase. You stop working on the technology there and then. This is single generation, but you are working in a technology where, for example, you are continuing to work for a long time, and technology also has a long life cycle. Then you have multiple generations of citations, where first set of citations again is referred by second set of citations and things like that. So citations is also one of the criteria. Then there is geographic extent. Of course, we all know what it is. And then the claim matrix we consider. So, for example, what is the scope of claim, and what is the quality of claim? So these two metrics I have considered. Looking at these two metrics, I'm just kind of trying to give you an example of two different areas where these two graphs, they kind of represent the ideal scenarios for two different kinds of technologies. So first one is engineering application. You can consider the first graph, which represents engineering application, is something which is typically based on general principles of engineering. In this kind of technology, commercialization is very fast. Now, why that happens is, for example, you consider softwares. So softwares, if we see, softwares are typically, they are based on incremental innovations. The core technology is already there. What you do is you do some, and the engineering principles are also there. So what happens is, if you are a software company and there is a competitor, both of you probably would be working on similar engineering principles, and you would be giving similar kind of solutions, maybe differentiating little bit from each other. So in these kind of this kind of technology, if you see the portfolio size, it doesn't reach a maximum portfolio size, which is typically there in technologies where which are not related to general engineering principles. It reaches a certain mass and then technology changes. So the portfolio size in this kind of technology is usually limited. The self citations also, if we see, for the similar reasons, because very quickly the technology is moving fast, so it will have only one level of patent citations at maximum. Then portfolio impetus, portfolio growth and shrinking is very fast, because as soon as you come up with new solutions, you really want to quickly commercialize it. You want to bring it to market, you want to make a prototype out of it, and that's why you want to protect it quickly as much as possible. So because of this reason, portfolio impetus is very high. Now look at claim quality and claim scope. In these kind of technologies, they have high financial implications. Returns of investment are really high. So that is why there is a lot of scope of getting into litigations. So in this kind of technologies, your claim quality and claim scope has to be very good. Look at geographic coverage. Of course, you want to expand. The penetration in a lot of geographies is high in these kind of technologies. So you want to really cover lot of geographies. I am talking about now another kind of industry in which the time to prototype the product is very high, and time to market or commercialize is also very high. For example, any research which is based on new scientific principles. Examples of those could be nanotechnology or fuel cells, things like that. So in this kind of industry, you would want to have a bigger portfolio size, of course, because even when the technology is in embryonic stage, you want to protect it from all the sides, because you don't know tomorrow. Since it is based on new principles, you want to protect it because tomorrow it will help you during the commercialization stage. Of course, I understand there are risks, because it may happen that it never takes up. But being an innovator and being somebody who is working in this technology, you would want to do that. Then self citations also have to be high in this case, because of course the technology is going to take long to take off, but then when it takes off, you want to reap maximum benefits of the core thing. It should not happen that you have developed the new thing and somebody else is taking credit of the derivative work that is being done. For similar reasons, you have geographic coverage also should be high. The claims should be of good quality. Portfolio impetus also should be high in this case. So you have these indicators. So what I have shown in the previous slide is actually a map of for example a near perfect map for that particular technology, that particular domain. So you have a blueprint. Now what I'm doing is, for example, I have my portfolio. I'm a big company. I have a portfolio. And I'm doing a SWOT analysis of my portfolio. So SWOT analysis, and if everything is goody-goody, I mean, of course, I don't really need to worry about things. However, if there are instances where my portfolio is not mapping onto the blueprint that I've just shown, it shows that there are certain weaknesses in my portfolio. So what I'll do is, I'll do a... I'll do a landscape of my portfolio and try to find out what are the weaknesses. So let us say I did a portfolio assessment and tried to find out these are the weaknesses. So these are three example cases I have considered here. And I try to map it with the technology life cycle. Now, technology life cycle, as we are all aware of, there's a S-curve which defines the technology life cycle. Here I'm considering only adoption, growth, and maturity phase of technology life cycle and not really talking about decline phase. We take an interaction of intersection of these two, the X-axis and Y-axis, to define the IP strategy of the company. So let us say I am taking the topmost row where I realize the weakness of my portfolio is probably the portfolio size and claim attributes. They are not good. So and I realize that I am in the adoption phase. So what should be my strategy at that time? I would want to promote the invention part in my organization. I would want to incentivize people. I'll build more patents. And there will be a legal strategy that I would want to incorporate in my organization, where legal will define clear rules that or lay down clear best practices that the portfolio, the claim, how to write claims, or maybe I'll conduct certain training sessions. I would want to protect whatever I am building right now. Now let us come to the growth stage. I am in the growth stage and I realize that portfolio size is not good and claim attributes are not good. Now in growth stage, of course, my strategy will be different than what was in the adoption stage. Why? Because in this case, I have certain patents which I had filed earlier. I want to maintain those patents. Of course, I want to do whatever I have done previously. But in addition to that, I want to maintain those patents, and then I will strategize the filing jurisdictions. I could not do it earlier because in adoption stage, the technology was not that mature. Now the technology has become mature. I know where I can file, so I'll strategize the filing jurisdictions. Then comes the maturity stage. In maturity stage, of course, it doesn't give me a liberty to really go and file the patents because the technology has matured and I don't have any white space available. So what I'll do is I'll try to acquire certain portfolios. I'll try to license in certain portfolios. And in case there are certain incremental innovations, for those incremental innovations, I can strategize whether I want to keep those as trade secrets or I want to do defensive publications. So because of paucity of time, I am not going to other things, but of course these will define the patent strategy. To end the presentation, I am just giving examples of the acquisition strategies and litigation strategies. So IBM has recently acquired three companies, and three of them, they are in cloud computing space. For one of the companies, I could gather this data which really talks about the cell citations. So if you compare with Google and Facebook, the cell citation percentage for this company is highest. Yeah. And last is the licensing strategy. So this is about BlackBerry. I think we all can read about it. So BlackBerry was dormant for a long time, but suddenly they have realized that it's a big portfolio. They can license it out. So they are into licensing right now. So yeah, thank you.